A human hair is about 50,000 to 100,000 nanometers wide. A virus is about 20 to 300 nanometers wide. And a fingernail grows 1 nanometer each second. When an ASML machine positions a wafer for DUV or EUV exposure, precise machinery must hit the exact right position to within a few nanometers. These margins of error boggled my mind and inspired this video. So how does an ASML lithography machine hold and move a wafer? It's magnets. But if you want to know more, let's dive in together. Alright people, let's do this one last time. An optical lithography machine is essentially a $150 million camera that uses high energy light to transfer a very complex chip design pattern onto a wafer, which is usually made of silicon, but not always. The workflow goes like this. First, we apply the photoresist, a complicated light-sensitive polymer chemical, onto the wafer using the spin coating method. After a few other preparatory steps, which are important but I won't mention, it goes into the lithography exposure tool. Inside the tool, we have several subcomponents: the light source, the condenser lenses, the photomask, and the objective lenses. Together, the light source and the condenser lenses make up the illumination system, or illuminator. Its job is to deliver light widely, evenly, and at adequate intensity to transfer the pattern. Illumination is very important, which is why ASML dedicates multiple mirrors in its EUV machine to illumination at the cost of significant power reduction. That illuminated light then passes through or bounces off of the photomask or reticle, which contains the chip design pattern. In the early days of the semiconductor industry, the whole mask contained the whole design, but as designs got more complicated, the industry started using reticles, which represent a portion of the whole chip design. Nowadays, since almost all masks are reticles, the terms are used interchangeably. Like the wafer, the reticle is placed on a positioning table so they can be moved to compensate for natural errors. A robot automatically handles the work of exchanging the reticle when needed. After the reticle slash mask, we have the objective lens. It collects and properly focuses the light and then shrinks down the image. The light then goes on to strike the resist-coated wafer. When done right, we now have a 3D relief of a portion of the chip design on the substrate. Later, we can make that design permanent using etch processes. The wafer and its stage are pretty heavy. Fully loaded with a 300 millimeter wafer, the stage weighs about 15 kilograms, which for illustration is the average weight of a grizzled tree kangaroo. The platform has to be able to move these wafers and their stages extremely quickly, but it also has to be capable of abruptly stopping and holding absolutely still if needed during the exposure stage. And at the exact right place too, just nanometers of margin. Machines need to have good, quote, overlay, end quote, meaning the relative position of any pattern layer relative to the others. Calculated as a percent of the feature size, overlays can get to be just a few nanometers. Errors will damage the device's capabilities and maybe even cause short circuits. Overlay requirements get even more strict when we are executing multi-patterning. That is when we use multiple exposures, positioned just right, to create lines smaller than before possible. Inside the machine, the wafer stage can accelerate to as much as 20 g-forces, 20 times the force of gravity, 3 times the maximum force on a Formula One car, or twice the maximum permitted force in a jet fighter. At the same time, the system has to execute these fast movements and changes in movements without causing vibrations. This is for obvious reasons. Vibrations throw off the precision targeting and cause errors. ASML evolved from Philips in the Netherlands. Philips has been building semiconductors for many years. Their machines reflect this heritage. Their products were first developed in Eindhoven at Philips's NAT lab. There, the lab produced its pioneering lithography machine, the silicon repeater. Some of Philips's first wafer steppers, like the PAS-2000, used hydraulic linear motors to move their wafer stages around. These systems use a high-pressure pump to push oil through hoses and valves to generate movement. Hydraulics worked well from a precision standpoint, but lacked the necessary reliability. With all the pumps and oil around, any leak would be utterly devastating in a clean room fab. So the Philips engineers built strong seals to prevent leakage, which bulked up the device. Semiconductor customers nevertheless refused to accept the product, in part contributing to ASML's rough early years. It is an example of over-engineering to fix a problem that shouldn't have existed in the first place. After a high-profile lab incident involving a burst hydraulic oil pump, the team decided to explore electrically driven systems. To build that system, Philips tapped their experience in producing the precursors of today's optical disc technologies like the compact disc. Earlier, Philips wanted to build a gramophone-like product but for video. But since video is so much more data-dense than audio, they replaced the gramophone stylus, which physically touched its disc, with a contactless optical laser. This approach required the creation of small, precise linear motors to control the unit, reading the information reflected back from the disc. Linear motors are motors that directly convert electricity to movement without the use of a rotor. They do so using the Lorentz law, exploiting how electric and magnetic fields interact with each other to generate motion forces. NatLab engineers realize that they can apply these same technologies to position the silicon wafer. Such systems were widely successful, and ASML machines are particularly known for their precise maneuvering. As we moved into the 2000s, the industry also moved from 200mm to 300mm wafers, while also shifting to a smaller node. The lithography machines had to be re-engineered from multiple criteria. They had to accommodate larger and heavier wafers, but at the same speeds and same demands. They also needed to process smaller features. While pondering a way to handle all of these issues, ASML created the TwinScan platform, their main brand of lithography machine. We call it the TwinScan because the machine runs on a dual stage cycle, measurement and exposure. During operation, there is a wafer on each stage, clamped and secured using electrostatic forces. The chuck has tens of thousands of burls to reduce direct contact to just 2% of the wafer surface area, cutting contamination risk. At the start, we load or unload the wafer into the machine using a robot called the wafer handler. They start off with the measurement stage. In the measurement stage, the machine runs through a series of scans. These scans help the computers prepare how to align the wafer in relation to the reticle to ensure good focus and accurate overlay. Then the machine swaps the stages, rotating the wafers. The measured wafer now goes under the lens, and the machine turns on the light source until we hit the required dose of light exposure. During the swap, the machine can use the downtime to exchange the reticle, though doing so requires a new reticle alignment step. In the twin scan, these wafer movements are coordinated by the Control Architecture Reference Model Motion Control Platform, or CARM. These are powered by a bunch of FPGAs and process controllers in a cabinet rack outside. This whole setup seems a bit obvious, but lithography machines prior to the twin scan ran all the measurement, alignment, and exposure steps sequentially on a single wafer. Pulling off the dual stage setup was a major engineering project. The tool's architecture had to be reworked to rebalance all the new weight and mass on the machine's frame, not to mention handling all the vibrations from two processes running at the same time. It required their lens and metrology equipment, mounted on what we call the metrology frame, to be isolated from the rest of the tool's main frame using air bearings, which use highly pressurized gas to cut friction. Key to hitting throughput benchmarks is not the exposure stage, but rather the measurement stage. A DUV machine handling 175 wafers per hour, average in the market, exposes each wafer for just 20 seconds of about 2-minute cycle. The rest of the time is spent on measurement. I'm reminded of one of my favorite documentaries, Jiro Dreams of Sushi. Sushi master Jiro says, "Customers think the staff in the kitchen have it easy, and they think the master making sushi has the hardest job. But in reality, the sushi is 95% complete before the fish is brought out to me." In the twin scan, the exposure stage is sexy and where all the economic value is added to the chip. But when the machine sends the wafer into exposure, the sushi needs to be pretty much complete. So for ASML, figuring out the right sequence of actions during measurement is crucial in shipping a competitive machine. Today, the TwinScan name has a number of product categories. NXE TwinScan machines do EUV lithography, NXT machines run with 193 nanometer ARF DUV light, and XT machines use 248 nanometer kerf DUV light. The NXE EUV machine can process 125 wafers an hour, so one every 2 minutes. Sophisticated DUV machines can even do 200 to 300 wafers. The numbers in the machine's name correspond to their optic systems and lenses. The machines themselves are built in a modular fashion per the customer's requirements, kind of like how PCs are. This is because machines are expected to run in customer fabs for decades. They are set up to receive upgrades to keep up with modern requirements. For this reason, there's a vast diversity even within the same category. The typical lithography machine has two movement systems inside. Systems transporting the wafer from one workstation to the other are referred to as the coarse stage. The motors handling these are referred to as long stroke because they are designed for extended range, about 1 meter, and high speed. Then we have the fine stage because they value precision over distance. As you might guess, we use what are called short stroke actuators, often voice coil motors, to handle this. To get this wide range of movements, systems are often stacked on top of each other, so the fine stage on top of the coarse stage. This is known to have caused weight issues as more stacking and movements are needed. It is interesting to review how precision movement technologies have progressed inside the machine. Early machines like the old Philips wafer stepper moved their wafers around using mechanical systems, like the aforementioned hydraulic linear motors. Tools like Canon's FPA-2000 photolithography machine for the 500 nanometer process node, introduced in 1992, used mechanical guides, kind of like rails, stacked one on top of the other for movement. But such computer-controlled systems suffered unexpected alignment errors due to friction, forces that act on the stage prior to motion. These little errors added up to create big problems. Worse, over time, that friction wore down the mechanical bearings. Then they need to be replaced, requiring expensive downtime and human intervention. In response, sometime during the 1990s and early 2000s, the industry implemented aerostatic systems. This means that they created a thin film of extremely dry air between the wafer stage and a granite slab. It's kind of like the puck on an air hockey table. This air cushioning cuts friction and reduces vibrations from the wafer stage's movements. For these machines, ASML used interferometers to track the stage's positioning, essentially lasers, mounted on sharks, of course, reflecting off a mirror mounted on the side of the stage. The precision guidelines are tight, so tight that additional calculations were needed to compensate for the refractive index of the air, which changed as the stage moved around. It threw off things by as much as 1 nanometer, which was unacceptable. Nevertheless, air-based systems did a fine job for many years. But as lithography continued to advance, cleanliness benchmarks like those for EUV would eventually require the presence of a vacuum. Air systems are not viable in a vacuum. So in preparation for this, ASML in the late 2000s began switching over to suspending their wafer stages using magnetic levitation. Magnets, how do they work? According to a 2017 presentation by a vendor, the wafer stage sits on top of a 1,400 kilogram magnet plate array with over 2,200 magnets, precision placed to within 20 micrometers. 1,457 of those magnets are arranged in a Halbach array, which is a special arrangement that strengthens the field on one side while canceling out on the other. For metrology purposes, ASML switched from lasers bouncing off the sides of the wafer stages to lasers firing down from a grid mounted over the stages. Now for NXT immersion systems, which are not in a vacuum, the metrology lasers don't have to travel so far, 15 millimeters versus as much as 300 previously. This simplified the air refractive index calculations and improved overlay. I appreciate the design thinking. Some of the challenges of the design include having to deal with errant magnetic fields interfering with the wafer, as well as cooling, which might require the use of umbilical cords or hoses impeding movement. I have seen some interesting proposals to use a single maglev system for generating both short and long stroke movements. Such a system would get rid of the stacked fine coarse stage system, saving on space and weight. It's a compelling idea and a lot of demonstrations are floating around, but the latest documentation that I have seen still shows the presence of separate electromagnetic motors for these different movements. An ASML machine has to position a 15 kilogram wafer stage with below nanometer accuracy. I, on the other hand, wear t-shirts because I have trouble buttoning my collars. Ergo, it's a little difficult for me to comprehend the insane precision necessary for this work. Something that I did not appreciate as much going into this project was just how big of a role software played. From 1989 to 2000, the number of CPUs and sensors in ASML's tools grew 6 and 8 times, respectively. That 1989 stepper, the PAS-5000, had a total of 200 million source code lines, including comments. The 2003 TwinScan has 1.25 billion lines. I know, you can't judge complexity by lines of code, but that caught my eye. This aggressive leveraging of software, the former CEO said that the team doubled in size every 4 years, is probably a key driver behind their strong performance. Worth looking at more down the line. All right, everyone, that's it for tonight. Thanks for watching. Subscribe to the channel, and I'll see you guys next time.